Data science is one of the hardest jobs today. According to LinkedIn, the data scientist job profile is among the top 10 jobs in the United States. According to Economic Times, the job postings for the data scientist profile have grown over 400 times in the past 1 year. So it is obvious that companies today survive on data, and data scientists are rock stars of this era. And if you want to start your career as a data scientist, you must be wondering what sort of questions are asked in a data science interview. So today, we'll be going through the most frequently asked questions in data science interviews.
Right, so we'll start off with the questions. So this is our first question over here. So we have this diamonds data set and we're supposed to extract only those rows where the price value is greater than 1000 and the cut is equal to ideal. So this is our data set over here. So we'd want to extract only those records where the value of the cut is equal to ideal and this price which you see and this price needs to be greater than 1000. And we are supposed to implement this with R. So let's do that. Now this diamonds dataset is a part of the ggplot2 package. So first we'll go ahead and load this ggplot2 package. So I'll use the command library of ggplot2. And then let me have a glance at this dataset. So I will use view of diamonds. And this is our diamonds dataset over here. So this is our dataset which comprises of these columns. Caret, cut, color, clarity, depth, table and so on. So our task was to extract only those records where the price value was greater than 1000 and the cut was equal to ideal. And to do that, we'll be using the dplyr package. So I'll be loading the dplyr package. So dplyr is basically a package which is based on grammar of data manipulation. And this is the command to extract those particular records. So first, what I'm doing is, from this diamonds dataset, I'll be using the filter function which is part of the dplyr package. And with the help of this filter function, I'm giving two conditions inside this. So the first condition is the price needs to be greater than 1000. After that, I'll use the AND operator and then given the second condition. So the second condition is the cut needs to be equal to ideal. And I'll store the result in diamonds 1000 ideal. I'll hit enter. Now let me have a glance at the result. View of diamonds 1000 ideal. So you see that there are 14,700 entries in total where the cut is equal to ideal and the price of the diamond is greater than 1000. So out of the 53,940 records, we have filtered out 14,700 records where the cut is equal to ideal and the price is greater than 1000. Now we have our second question over here. So on the same diamonds dataset, we are supposed to make a scatter plot between the price and the caret. And we are supposed to do that using the ggplot2 package. So over here, the price needs to be on the y-axis and the caret needs to be on the x-axis. So this column, it needs to be on the x-axis. And then we have price. This needs to be on the y-axis. And the color of the points need to be determined by the cut value. So again, let's head back to R and let's implement this. So again, to implement the scatter plot using ggplot, we are supposed to load the ggplot2 package. All right. And this would be a command to make that particular scatter plot. So ggplot2 is something which is based on grammar of data visualization. So ggplot helps us to stack multiple layers on top of each other. So first off, we'll start with the data layer. On top of the data layer, we'll stack the aesthetics layer. And on top of the aesthetics layer, we'll stack the geometry layer. So first, we have the data layer where we'll give the name of the data frame to this data attribute. And we are working with the diamonds data frame. So the first layer is diamonds. After that, we will map these columns onto the aesthetics. So using this aesthetics attribute inside this ggplot function, I will map this caret column to the x aesthetic, and similarly I will map this price column onto the y aesthetic. And as the question stated, the color of these points need to be determined by the cut column. So again, I'm reiterating it. Caret is mapped onto the x aesthetic, price is mapped onto the y aesthetic, and cut is mapped onto the color aesthetic. And once these two layers are done, we are supposed to build the final layer, which is basically the geometry. And since we are supposed to make a scatter plot, we'll be using the geom point geometry. And this gives us the required scatter plot. Let me zoom this. So as we see over here, price is mapped onto the y-axis, carat is mapped onto the x-axis, and these colors which you see, these basically denote the different cut values. So yellow, it denotes the ideal cut, and this purple which you see, that denotes the fair cut. So we see that if the cut is fair, then mostly the price of the diamond is higher and also the carat value is higher. And when it comes to the ideal cut, we see that the carat range of the ideal cut, it starts from 0 and it's mostly till 3 or 4. So this is the sort of interpretation which we can make from the scatter plot. And then we have our next question. So this time, we are supposed to introduce 25% missing values in the iris data set and impute the sepal length column with the mean and similarly impute the petal length column with the median. So this is the iris dataset. So again, let's head back to our studio and perform these tasks. Let me have a glance at the iris dataset first. View of iris. So this is our iris dataset, which comprises of these 5 columns. So we have sepal length, sepal width, petal width, and species. And our first task is to introduce 25% missing values in this entire dataset. And that'll be totally random. And to introduce missing values, we'll be using the missForest package. So let me load the missForest package using the library function. Now, this missForest package comprises of this prodAny function. And using this prodAny function, I'll be introducing 25% missing values. So this basically takes in two parameters. First is the data frame or the object into which we are supposed to introduce missing values. The second parameter is the percentage of missing values that we'd want to introduce. So in this iris data frame, we are supposed to introduce 25% missing values. So I'll give the value of 0.25 and I'll store this in a new object and name that object to be iris.mis. Now let me have a glance at this modified dataset. View of iris.mis. So this is a new data frame which comprises of 25% missing values. Now I'm supposed to impute the sepal length column with the mean and similarly this petal length column with the median. And to impute those two columns separately, I would require the HMISC package. So I'll load this package now. Library of HMISC. And this package comprises of the impute function with the help of which I'll be imputing different columns. So first I'll use the width function and this takes in two parameters. First is the data frame which consists of missing values. So in this data frame we are supposed to impute the missing values. So this is the iris.mis data frame and this is the first parameter. Next we'll use the impute function. And inside the impute function, again, it takes in two parameters. First is the column which we want to impute. Next is the function by which we want to impute this column. So I want to impute the missing values in the column with the mean of this column. So wherever you see any values in this column, all of those values would be replaced with the mean of this column. And I'll store the result back to this column, which is iris.mis$sepal-length. I'll hit enter. Now let me have a glance at this imputed dataset. So view of iris.mis. So you see that wherever we had the any values, all of those values have been imputed with the mean. So this 5.85562, which you see, this is nothing but the mean. So initially there was an any value over here and that has been imputed with the mean. Similarly, there was an any value over here and that has been imputed with the mean of this column. Next, similarly, we are supposed to impute this column with the median of this column. So let us do that. So again, I'll use the width function and then pass in this data frame with the missing values. After that, I'll use the impute function and I am supposed to impute this petal length column. And the imputation would be done with the help of the median function. So wherever there are any values, all of those any values would be replaced with the median of this column. And the final result, I'll store it back to the same column. I'll hit enter. Now again, let me have a glance at the modified data frame. So view of iris.mis. So this is our modified data frame. So this 4.2 which you see, this is nothing but the median of this column, right? So wherever there were any values, those any values have been replaced with the median of the petal length. Now let's head on to the next question. So what do you understand by linear regression? Well, linear regression is a supervised learning algorithm which helps us in finding the linear relationship between two variables. So one is the predictor or the independent variable, and the other is the response or the dependent variable. So we try to understand how does the dependent variable change with the independent variable. So linear regression is a supervised learning algorithm which helps us in finding the linear relationship between two variables. So one is the predictor or the independent variable, and the other is the response or the dependent variable. And we try to understand how does the dependent variable change with the independent variable. So let's say there's this telecom company called as Neo. And now the data scientist at this company wants to understand if there's a linear relationship between the monthly charges incurred by the customer and the tenure of the customer. So he collects all of the data and builds a linear model between the monthly charges and the tenure. So here, monthly charges would be the dependent variable and tenure would be the independent variable. And in linear regression, there could be more than one independent variable. So if there's just one independent variable, it is known as simple linear regression. And if there's more than one independent variable, it is known as multiple linear regression. So guys, this is the underlying concept of linear regression, where we have one dependent variable and multiple or a single independent variable, and we try to understand the linear relationship between the dependent variable and the independent variables. So next, we are supposed to implement this simple linear regression in R on this empty cars dataset, where the dependent variable is this MPG column and the independent variable is this displacement column. So again, let's head back to R Studio and implement the simple linear regression. So this is our empty cars data frame, which comprises of all these columns. So we have MPG, the number of cylinders, displacement, horsepower, DRAT, weight, Qsec, VS, AM, gear, and carb. So as the question stated, MPG is our dependent variable and displacement is our independent variable. And we want to try to understand how does MPG vary with respect to the displacement of this column. So now, before we go ahead and implement the model on top of this data frame, we are supposed to divide this data frame into training and testing set so that the model does not overfit the data. So what happens when we don't divide the data set into training and testing sets is it overfits this data set. And when we give it new data, it'll fail miserably on that new data. So that is why it is always necessary to divide a data set into train and test sets. So let's go ahead and do that. And to divide a data set, we would require this caret package. So let me load up this caret package, library of caret. And this caret package comprises of the create data partition function. Now, this create data partition function would give me true or false labels. And this create data partition function comprises of these parameters over here. First is the column which determines the split. So that is obviously the MPG column. And then we are supposed to give in the split ratio. So I am giving the split ratio would be 0.65. That is, 65% of the labels of this column would have the true label, and the rest 35% of the records would have the false label. And I am storing this into the split tag object. So again, I'm reiterating it. So I am taking this empty cars$MPG column data set, and 65% of the records would have the true tag associated with it, and the rest 35% of the records would have the false tag associated with it. And I'm storing this result in split tag object. Now, once I have the split tag object ready, what I'll do is, from this entire empty cars data frame, I'll select all of those records where the split tag value is true, and I will store those records in the training set. Similarly, from the empty cars data frame, wherever the split tag value is equal to false. So if I just give in split tag, it'll have all of the true values in it. And when I put in the minus symbol in front of the split tag object, it'll contain all of the false labels. And I will select all of these records and store them in the test set. So now we have our training and testing sets ready. Now let's have a look at the number of rows in training and testing set. So I'll type in n row of train. So see that there are 23 rows in the training set. Similarly, I'll type in n row of test. And now we see that there are 9 rows in the testing set. Now we'll go ahead and build our model on top of the training set. And to build the simple linear model, we would require the LM function. This LM function again takes in two parameters. First is the formula. So over here, the formula is MPG tilde symbol displacement. So whatever column we give on the left side of the tilde symbol, that is taken as the dependent variable. And whatever columns we give on the right side of the tilde symbol, all of them are taken as the independent variables. So this time, MPG is our dependent variable and displacement is our independent variable. And we are building this model on top of the train set. And we'll store this result in mod underscore empty cars. So now that we've built the model on top of the train set, it's time to predict the values on top of the test set. So for that purpose, we'll be using this predict function, which again takes in two parameters. First parameter is the model which we've built. And the second parameter is the data frame on which you want to predict values. So you want to predict values for the test set. And I will store this in predict empty cars. Now let me have a glance at the predicted values. So head of pred empty cars. So these are the predicted values of MPG for all of these cars. So Mazda RX-4 WAG, the mileage predicted for this car is 22.55. The mileage predicted for Valiant is 20.04. The mileage predicted for Mercedes is 18.08 and so on. So this is how we can build a simple linear model on top of this empty cars dataset. So now we'd have to calculate the RMSE value for the model built. Now when we actually build a regression model, it predicts certain Y values associated with a given X value. But there always is an error associated with this prediction. So to get an estimate of average error during prediction, RMSE or root mean square error is used. So again, let's go ahead and calculate the RMSE value for the model which we've just built. So now that we have the actual values and the predicted values, let's bind both of them into a single data frame. So for that purpose, I will use the cbind function, and our actual values are basically present in this MPG column from the test set. And our predicted values are stored in this pred empty cars object, which we had created in the previous question. So I will create this new column and name that column to be actual. And again, similarly, I'll create another column and I'll name it as predicted, which would have the predicted values. And I will store this in a new object and name that to be final data. Let me have a glance at it. View of final data. So these are the actual values of all of the mileage. And these are the predicted values of the mileage for these cars. Now we see that there is an error present in the prediction. Now what we have is actually a matrix. So we are supposed to convert this matrix into a data frame. So I will use the as.dataframe function and convert this object into a data frame. So as.dataframe, I'll pass in this object, which is final data, and I'll store the result in final data again. Now I'll have a glance at the same thing. View of final data. So these are the actual values. These are the predicted values. And we see that there is an error present in the prediction. Now the error is basically the difference between the actual values and the predicted values. So let's go ahead and calculate the error in prediction for each of these records. So to calculate the error, all I have to do is subtract the predicted values from the actual value. So it'll be final data dollar actual minus final data dollar predicted. And I will store this result in a new object and name that object to be error. So now that we've done this, I will also go ahead and bind this error calculated to the same final data frame. So cbind, I'll bind the error object to this final data and I'll store the result in final data again. So it'll be view of final data. So this time we have the actual values, we have the predicted values, and we also have the error in prediction for each of these records. Now to get the average error, which is present throughout all of the predictions, you would have to calculate the root mean square error. So the root mean square error, as the name states, first we'd have to calculate the error, then we'd have to take the square of it, then we'd have to take the mean of it, and then finally we'll take the square root. So this is how we can calculate the root mean square error. So final data dollar error, and we'll square this error first. After that, we'll take the mean of this squared error And then finally, we'll take the square root of the mean squared error. So this is what we have. So the RMSE value for this model which we built is 4.33. Now you guys need to keep in mind that the lower the value of RMSE is, the better the model. So let's see, if we had some other model and the RMSE value for that model was 5, then this model would be better than that model. Similarly, let's say if another model's RMSE value was 2, then the second model would be better than the model which you've built. Now, similarly, we are supposed to implement simple linear regression in Python on this Boston dataset, where the dependent variable is this MADV column and the independent variable is the LSTAT column. So now in the data science interview questions, it's not necessary that you'll be asked questions only with respect to one programming language. So you might be asked questions with respect to R and Python, both of them. So that's why it's necessary to be good with both of these languages. Right, so I'll head on to Jupyter Notebook and implement simple linear regression on top of this Boston dataset. So I'll start off by loading the pandas package. So I'll type in import pandas as pd. And then I'll load this Boston dataset, and to load the dataset, I'll be using the read_csv function. So pd.read_csv and the name of the file, which is boston.csv, and I'll store this in the data object. So now that we've loaded the data, let me have a glance at the head of this data. So these are all the columns and the first 5 records present in the data frame. So we have crim, zn, indus, cas, nox, age, and so on. And for the task of simple linear regression, MADV is our dependent variable and LSTAT is our independent variable. So this MADV is basically the median value of price of the houses. And we are trying to understand what is the median value of the price of the houses with respect to this LSTAT column over here. Now, before we go ahead and implement the model, let's understand the dataset a bit more. So I'll use this data.shape, which would give me the number of rows and columns present in this data frame. So we see that there are 506 rows in total and 14 columns in total. Now I'll go ahead and separate the independent and dependent variable from this entire data frame. So for that purpose, I'll use this data.loc, and since I want all of the records, I'll take all of the records, and the only columns which I want from this entire data frame are LSTAT and MADV. And I'll store this result in data 1, and I'll also have a glance at the first 5 records of this data frame. So these are the first 5 records of this new data frame where I have only LSTAT and MADV columns. Now I'll also go ahead and do a bit of visualization with respect to these two columns. And for that purpose, I would require the matplotlib package. So I'll go ahead and import this matplotlib package as well. So here what I'm doing is, I am mapping the LSTAT column onto the x-axis and the MADV column onto the y-axis. And I will give the label of the x-axis as LSTAT and the label of the y-axis as MADV. And finally, I'll show this graph which I've built. So what I've built is basically a scatter plot where MADV is on the y-axis and LSTAT is on the x-axis. So you see that as LSTAT increases, MADV decreases. So there is an inverse relationship between MADV and LSTAT. So again, I'm reiterating it, as LSTAT increases, MADV decreases. So this tells us that there is an inverse relationship between MADV and LSTAT columns. Now to build the model, we are supposed to separate the independent variable and dependent variable into two separate objects. So I'll take this LSTAT column from data 1 and store it into X object. Similarly, I'll take this MADV column from data 1 object and store it in Y object over here. So X consists of my independent variable and Y consists of my dependent variable. Now it's time to divide the data set into training and test sets. So we have this train test split function from sklearn.modelSelection. I'll go ahead and load that function. And this function over here takes these three parameters. So X and Y are basically the dependent variable and the independent variable. And then we have test size is equal to 0.2. So this states that 80% of the records would be in the training set and 20% of the records would be in the testing set. So it's a 80-20 split. And this random state which you see, so this is basically a seed value, so that if I want to get the same values again, I can set the same random state to get the same values. And I am storing these values in xtrain X test, Y train, and Y test. So X train contains all of the train values for that independent variable. X test contains all of the test values for the independent variable. Similarly, Y train contains all of the train values for the dependent variable, and Y test contains all of the test values for the dependent variable. So now that we have X train, X test, Y train, and Y test, it's finally time to build the model. So I'll go ahead and load the linear regression model from sklearn.linearModel, and then I'll fit the model. So first I'll create an instance of this. So linear regression, and I'll create an instance, and I'll name that instance to be regressor. And with the help of this instance, I'll fit the model on top of the training set. So regressor.fit, and I will pass in X train and Y train. So to sum it up, what I'm basically doing is building the linear regression model on top of the training set, which basically comprises of the independent variable and the dependent variable. I'll click on run. Now let me have a glance at the intercept and the m value of it. So linear regression is nothing but y equals mx plus c, and that c is nothing but the intercept. So you see that the intercept is 34.12. And m, which you see, this is the coefficient. This coefficient is nothing but the slope. And you see that the coefficient is minus 0.91. So there is a negative value associated with the coefficient because there is an inverse relationship between the dependent variable and the independent variable, as we saw over here. So as LSTAT increases, MEDV decreases. And that is the reason this coefficient is associated with a negative value. So now that we've built the model, it's time to predict the values on top of the test set. So again, I'll use this instance, and I will use the predict function with the help of this instance. So regressor.predict, and I will pass in this X test object inside this function, and I'll store this in the Y pred object. So we've built the model, and we've also predicted the values. Now let me have a glance at the number of rows and columns of the actual values and the predicted values. So we see that both the predicted values and the actual values comprises of 102 records in total. So now that we predicted the values, we'll go ahead and calculate some metrics. So we'll find out the mean absolute error, the mean squared error, and the root mean squared error. I'll click on run. So see that the mean absolute error for this model is 4.69, the mean squared error is 43, and the root mean squared error is 6.62. So again, the lower the values of these three, it means the better the model is. So let's say if we are comparing these values with some other model, and if these values are less than that second model, then the first model would be better than the second model. So that was implementing simple linear regression in Python. Now we have a next question over here. So the question is, what do you understand by logistic regression? Well, logistic regression is actually a classification algorithm which can be used when the dependent variable is binary. So let's take this example. So here we are trying to determine whether it will rain or not on the basis of temperature and humidity. That is, temperature and humidity are the independent variables, and rain would be our dependent variable. That is, we're trying to understand whether it'll rain or not on the basis of the temperature and the humidity. And again, logistic regression algorithm, it actually produces an S-curve. So let's say x-axis over here, it represents the number of runs scored by Virat Kohli, and the y-axis represents the probability of Team India winning the match. So let's say this point over here, it denotes 50 runs. So what we can see from this graph is, so if Virat Kohli scores more than 50 runs, then there is a greater probability for Team India to win the match. And similarly, if Virat Kohli scores less than 50 runs, then the probability of Team India winning the match is less than 50%. So let's take this value here. So let's say the number of runs scored by Virat Kohli is around 60. So if the number of runs scored by Virat Kohli is around 60, then the probability of Team India winning the match would be, let's say, around 65% or so. Again, let's take this value here. So let's say this is around 97 runs or 95 runs. And if Virat Kohli scores 95 or 97 runs, then the probability of Team India winning the match is 1, which is 100%, isn't it? So similarly, this value here. So let's say this is around 5 runs or 10 runs. So if Virat Kohli scores 5 or 10 runs, then the probability of Team India winning the match is zero. So basically, in logistic regression, the y value lies within 0 and 1 range. And this is how logistic regression works. So now we are supposed to implement logistic regression on this hard data set, where the dependent variable is this target column and the independent variable is the age column. So let's go ahead and implement logistic regression. So let me start off by loading this data set first. I'll use the read.csv function. Now let me have a glance at this data set, view of heart. So this is our entire data frame, and this target which you see, this is our dependent variable, and we have the age column over here, and this is the independent variable. So we are actually supposed to rename this. So we see that the column name is incorrect over here. So our first task could be to rename this column. Let me go ahead and do that. So I'll use the column names function, and I'll pass in this data frame, which is heart, and I am supposed to rename the first column. So I'll give in 1 inside the parenthesis, and I will rename this to be age. So now again, let me have a glance at this modified data frame. So it'll be view of heart. So see that we have successfully renamed this column from IH to age. Now let me have a structure of this data frame. So structure of heart. So see that most of these are integers. But then again, since we are building a logistic regression model on top of this data set, this final target column is supposed to be categorical. It cannot be an integer. So we'll go ahead and convert this into a factor. So I'll use the as.factor function and convert this integer value into a categorical value. So as.factor, and I'll pass in this column over here, which is heart$target, and I'll store the result back to heart$target. Now again, let me have a glance at the structure. So that will be structure of heart$target. So initially it was integer. Now we have converted that integer column into a categorical value, which has two levels, which are 0 and 1. So now I'll actually build a simple logistic regression model, and I'll not divide this data set into training and testing sets. So we'll do this and we'll see what are the different probability values for the person to have heart disease on the basis of the different age values. And to build the logistic regression model, we'll be using the GLM function. So again, this takes in 3 parameters over here. First parameter is the formula. So here, target$age is the formula, which basically indicates that target is our dependent variable and age is our independent variable. And we are building this model on top of the entire data frame, and family is equal to binomial. So when we state family is equal to binomial, we are basically telling R that this is a logistic regression model, and I'll store the result in log mod 1. So now let me have a glance at the summary of the model which we've just built. So summary of log mod 1. So we have this p value over here, and we see that there are 3 stars associated with this p value. So this basically means that we can reject the null hypothesis. That is, the null hypothesis states that there is no relationship between the age and the target columns. But since we have 3 stars over here, this states that the null hypothesis can be rejected and there is a strong relationship between the age column and the target column. Now again, we have other parameters over here. So we have something known as null deviance and residual deviance. So simply put, the lower the deviance value, the better the model. So this null deviance basically tells us the deviance of the model when we don't have any independent variables. That is, when we are trying to predict the value of the target column with only the intercept. So if that's the case, then null deviance is 417.64. And residual deviance is that deviance when we include the independent variables and try to predict the target column. So when we include the independent variable, which is age, we see that the residual deviance drops. So initially, when there were no independent variables, the null deviance was 417. After we included the age column, we see that the null deviance has reduced to 401. So this basically means that there is a strong relationship between the age column and the target column, and that is why the deviance has reduced. So now that we've built the model, we will go ahead and predict some values. So now I want to know the probability of the person not having heart disease when his age is equal to 30. So now let me actually head back to this data frame over here. So the values in this target column, it is 0 and 1. So when we predict the values, we get the prediction for 0. That is the person not having heart disease. So when the person's age is 30, we see that the probability of the person not having heart disease is 81.2%. Now similarly, I'll predict the probability of the person not having heart disease when the age is 50. So when the age is 50, we see that the person not having heart disease, the probability, it comes down to 60%. Now what I'll do is, I'll predict the values for a set of age values. So this time the age value, it starts at 29 and it goes on till 77. So I'll get a set of predictions starting from 29 to 77. So you see that when the age is 29, the probability of the person not having heart disease is 82%. Similarly, when the age of the person is 30, the probability of the person not having heart disease is 81%. So as the age increases from 29 to 77, the probability of the person not having heart disease decreases. So this is the final case over here when the age of the person is 77. So when the age of the person is 77, the probability that the person does not have a heart disease is 26%. So this is quite an interesting relationship, isn't it? So we see that as the age of the person increases, there is more likelihood that the person would have heart disease. So this model we built on top of the entire data set. Now what we'll do is, we'll divide this data set into train and test sets and build the model on top of the train set and predict the values on top of the test set. So again, for that purpose, I would require this caret package. So library of caret. Again, this caret package comprises of the create data partition function. So this takes in these parameters over here. So this is the split criteria, which is heart dollar target. That is, I want to split this data frame with respect to this target column. And the split ratio, which I'm stating over here, is 0.7. That is, 70% of the records would have the true label associated with them, and the rest 30% records would have the false label associated with them. And the final result, I am storing it in split tag. Now, what I'll do is, from the entire heart data frame, whichever records have the true label associated with them in the split tag, I'll take all of those records and I'll store them in the training set. Similarly, from the entire heart data frame, wherever the split tag value is equal to false, I'll take all of them and I will store them in the test set. So I have my training and my testing sets ready. Now let me have a glance at the number of rows of the training and testing set. So n row of train, there are 213 rows, and n row of test, there are 90 rows. So now that we have the training and testing sets ready, let me go ahead and build the model on top of the training set. So again, we'll use this glm function and build the model. So this time the formula is the same, which is basically target tilde symbol age. So target is the dependent variable, age is the independent variable, and we're trying to determine the probability of the patient having heart disease with respect to his age. And we are building this model on top of the train set. And since this is a logistic regression model, the family would be equal to binomial, and I'll store this result in log mod 2. Now that we've built the model, it's time to predict the values. So I'll use the predict function, and this again takes in these three parameters. First is the model which we've just built, and then second parameter is the object on which you want to predict the values. So we want to predict the values on top of the test set. And finally, we'll set the type to be equal to response, which will basically give us probabilities for these predictions. And I'll store the result in pred heart. So let me have a look at the range of the predicted values. So we see that the range of the predicted values of the heart disease, it varies from 0.21 to 0.86. That is, the probability of the patient having heart disease, it varies from 21% to 86%. And this is how we can build a simple logistic regression model on top of this heart disease data set. Now let's head on to the next question. So what is a confusion matrix? So confusion matrix is actually a table which is used to estimate the performance of a model. It tabulates actual values and the predicted values in a 2x2 matrix. So these are the actual values and these are the predicted values. So this what you see, true positives. So this denotes all of those records where the actual values were true and the predicted values were also true. So these denote all of the true positives. After that, we have the false negatives. So false negatives denotes all of those records where the actual values were true, but the predicted value was false. So where the actual value is true, but the predicted value is false, that is known as a false negative. Then we have false positives. So in false positive, the actual value is false, but the predicted value is true. And such values are known as false positives. And finally, we have the true negatives where the actual values are false and the predicted values are also false. So if we want to get the correct values, then correct values would basically represent all of the true positives and the true negatives. And this is how confusion matrix actually works. So now we are supposed to build a confusion matrix for the model which we built, where the threshold value for the probability of predicted values is 0.6. And then we have to find the accuracy of the model. So as I've already stated, accuracy is basically true positives plus true negatives upon all of the values. So this left diagonal represents all of those values which have been correctly classified. And this right diagonal represents all of those values which have been incorrectly classified. So when we divide the left diagonal with all of the values, that is when we'll get the accuracy of the model. So let's go to RStudio and find out the accuracy of the model which we built. So to build a confusion matrix in R, we'll be using the table function. And inside the table function, first we'll give in the actual values and then we'll give the predicted values. So the actual values are stored in this target column of the test set and the predicted values are stored in the predhart object which we had created. And then we saw that the range of the probabilities, it was from 0.2 to 0.8. So from that range of 0.2 to 0.8, I am setting a probability threshold of 0.6. That is, wherever the probability is greater than 0.6, it'll be classified as 0. Or in other words, it'll be classified that the person does not have heart disease. And similarly, wherever the probability is less than 0.6, it'll be classified as 1. Or in other words, that the patient has heart disease. So I'm reiterating it again. So wherever the probability of predhart is greater than 0.6, it'll be classified as 0. And wherever the probability of predhart is less than 0.6, it'll be classified as 1. So let's go ahead and build a confusion matrix. So see that this is our confusion matrix and this left diagonal represents all of those values which have been correctly classified. And this right diagonal represents all of those values which have been incorrectly classified. And if you want to find the accuracy, all we have to do is divide this left diagonal with all of the values. So that'll be 31 plus 17 divided by 31 plus 17 plus 10 plus 32. So you see that we get an overall accuracy of 53% for this model which you built. Now let's head on to the next question. So what do you understand by true positive rate and false positive rate? So let's start with true positive rate. So in machine learning, true positive rate, which is also referred to as sensitivity or recall, is used to measure the percentage of actual positives which are correctly identified. So the formula for true positive rate is true positives divided by all the positives. So I am stating it again. True positive rate is basically the measure of the percentage of actual positives which have been correctly identified. Now let's look at false positive rate. So false positive rate is basically the probability of falsely rejecting the null hypothesis for a particular test. So the false positive rate is calculated as the ratio between the number of negative events wrongly categorized as positive, that is all of the false positives, upon the total number of actual events. So this is how we can calculate true positive rate and false positive rate. Now we have the next question and we're supposed to explain what is ROC curve. So ROC curve, which actually stands for receiver operating characteristic, is basically a plot between the true positive rate and the false positive rate. and it helps us to find out the right trade-off between the true positive rate and the false positive rate for different probability thresholds of the predicted values. So the closer the curve is to the upper left corner, the better the model is. Or in other words, whichever curve has greater area under it, that would be the better model. So let's say we have this curve over here, and let's say there is another curve which goes like this, which is nearer to this upper left corner. Then in that case, since the second curve covers greater area under it, that would be a better model than the first model. So this ROC curve helps us to find out the area under the curve as well as the right trade-off between the true positive rate and the false positive rate. Now we are supposed to build the ROC curve on top of the logistic regression model which we've built. So let's head back to RStudio and do that. So to build the ROC curve, we would have to load the ROCR package. So I'll use the library function and load up the ROCR package. Now, this ROCR package comprises of the prediction function, which would give me a prediction object. So this takes in two parameters. First parameter is all of the predicted values. So this spread hat comprises of all of the predicted probabilities for the target column. And the second parameter is the labels of the dependent variable. So test$target has all of the labels of the dependent variable. And I will store this result of the prediction object in ROC pred hat. So now that we've created the prediction object, we can go ahead and build the ROC curve. And to build the ROC curve, we'll use the performance function, which is again a part of the ROCR package. So this over here takes in three parameters. First is the prediction object which you built. So the name of the object was ROC pred hat. After that, we will just give in TPR and FPR. So TPR and FPR stands for true positive rate and false positive rate. So for this prediction object which we built, we are basically trying to find out the right trade-off between the true positive rate and the false positive rate, and I'm storing the result in ROC curve. Now, let me go ahead and plot this ROC curve which I've just built. So this is our ROC curve over here. Let me zoom this. So we have this curve for different probability values over here. So this what you see are the different probability values. And our ideal curve should be something like this, where we have more of true positives and less of false positives. And this green color which you see, so this green color actually represents the ideal threshold value. So the ideal threshold value over here would be somewhere between 0.48 and 0.62. So this is where we would have the ideal threshold value of the probability. And this is somewhere where we can get the right trade-off between the true positive rate and the false positive rate. So maybe it could be this over here. So this point which we see, so this, the probability would be somewhere around 0.5 or somewhere around 0.55. So this is where we could get the right trade-off between the true positive rate and the false positive rate. So now that we've built a logistic regression model in R, again, we need to know how to build a logistic regression model in Python. So this time we are supposed to build this logistic regression model on top of this customer churn data frame, where the dependent variable is this churn column and the independent variable is this monthly charges column. And after that, we are supposed to find out the log loss of the model. So we are basically trying to determine whether the customer would churn or not on the basis of this monthly charges column. So again, I'll start off by loading the pandas data frame and also load the customerchurn.csv file. And for that purpose, I'll be using the pd.readcsv function. Right, so we have successfully loaded the file. Now it's time to have a glance at the head of this data set. So these are the different columns which we have. So we have this customer ID, then we have the gender of the customer. We have the senior citizen column, which tells us whether the customer is a senior citizen or not. This column tells us whether the customer has a partner or not. This column tells us if the customer has any dependents or not, the tenure of the customer, whether the customer has phone service or not, and so on. Sort of all of these columns, the columns which are of our concern would be the monthly charges column and churn column. So this monthly charges column basically tells us the monthly charges incurred by the customer in dollars. And this churn column tells us whether the customer would churn or not. So now since we have the data set with us, Let me go ahead and separate the dependent variable and the independent variable into two separate objects. So I'll store this monthly charges column from this customer churn data frame in the X object. Similarly, I'll store this churn column from the customer churn data frame in the Y object. So we have our dependent variable and independent variable to be separate. Now I'll go ahead and divide this model into training and testing set. And for that purpose, I would require this train test split function, which is part of the sklearn.modelSelection package. Now I'll use this train test split function, and this takes in these parameters. First are basically the independent variable and the dependent variable. So the independent variable is stored in X and the dependent variable is stored in Y. After that, I'll set the test size to be equal to 0.3. So this basically states that 70% of the records would be in the training set and the rest 30% of the records would be in the test set. And again, I'll set a random state value so that I can use the same values again if I want to. And I am storing all of these values into xtrain, xtest, ytrain and ytest. So xtrain comprises of the training set of the independent variable. Similarly, xtest comprises of the test set for the independent variables. After that, we have ytrain, which comprises of training set for the dependent variable. And then we have ytest, which is the test set for the dependent variable. So now we have xtrain, xtest, ytrain and ytest. It's time to build the model, predict the values and get the log loss value. So first I will import this logistic regression function from this sklearn.linearModel package, and I'll create an instance of logistic regression. I'll store it in L and then I'll fit the model on top of the training set. So L.fit, and I'm fitting the model on top of xtrain and ytrain. After that, I'll predict the probabilities on top of the test set. So L.predict_proba, and I'll pass in x_test, and I'll store the predicted probabilities in y_pred. So now that we've fit the model and also predicted the probabilities, it's time to look at the metrics. So the question stated that we were supposed to find out the log loss. So I'll just import the log loss from sklearn.metrics. And inside this log loss function, I will pass in the actual values and the predicted values. So actual values are stored in ytest and predicted values are stored in ypred. So we get a log loss value of 0.55. Now again, similar to RMSE, the lower the value of log loss, the better the model is. So again, let's say if there is another model and the log loss value of that second model is less than this, then that second model would be better than this model. Now we'll head on to the next question. So what do you understand by decision tree? So decision tree is a supervised learning algorithm which is used for both classification and regression. Right. So decision tree can be used for both classification purpose as well as regression purpose. So in this case, the dependent variable can be both a numerical value as well as a categorical value. So it is a flowchart like structure where the topmost node is known as the root node. The internal nodes with children are known as the branch nodes, and the final nodes without children are known as the leaf nodes. So here, each node actually denotes a test on an attribute, and each edge represents an outcome of the test, and each leaf node holds a class label. So let's say this first node over here, we are trying to determine the age of the patient. So let's say if the age of the patient is greater than 50. If the condition is true, we'll come here. If the condition is false, then we'll come here. After that, over here, we'll check if the person smokes or not. And if that person smokes, we'll come here. If that person doesn't smoke, we'll come here. Similarly, over here, the test condition could be whether the patient has any children or not. If the condition is true, we'll come here. If the condition is false, we'll come here. So this is how the decision tree works. And finally, we'll have class labels over here. So these would represent individual class labels. So let's say this represents that the person has cancer. This represents that the person does not have cancer. Similarly, this would represent that the person has cancer. And again, this would represent that the person does not have cancer. So in decision tree, we basically have a series of test conditions which would give us the final class labels. Right. So now we have to build a decision tree model on top of this iris dataset, where the dependent variable is the species column and all other columns are independent variables. And after we build the model, we are supposed to find out the accuracy of the model. So let's go ahead and do this. So I'll start off by having a glance at the iris dataset. View of iris. So this is our data frame, which comprises of all of these columns over here. And to build a decision tree model, we'll be loading the party package. So library of party. So again, before I go ahead and build the model, our task is to first divide this data frame into training and testing sets. So again, I will load up this caret package, library of caret. I'll use this create data partition function. And this create data partition function takes in the species column as the split column. And I'll give the split criteria to be 0.65. That is 65% of the records would be having the true label and the rest 35% of the records would be having the false label. And I'll store that in split tag. Now, from the iris dataset, wherever the value of split tag is equal to true, I'll store that in the train set. Similarly, from the entire iris dataset, wherever the value of split tag is equal to false, I'll store that in the test set. Now again, let me have a glance at the number of rows of the training and testing set. So you see that there are 99 rows in the training set and there are 51 rows in the testing set. So now again that the train test split is done, we can go ahead and build a model. And to build the model, we'll be using the ctree function, which is a part of the party package. So this again takes in two parameters. First parameter is the formula. Next parameter is the data set on which we are supposed to build the model. So here the formula is species tilde dot. So this tells us that species column is the dependent variable. And when you put a dot on the right side of the tilde symbol, that basically means that all other columns except the dependent variable are the independent variables. So sepal length, sepal width, petal length and petal width, all of them would be the independent variables and species would be the dependent variable. And again, we are building this model on top of the train set and I'll store this result in my tree object. So now that we've built the model, let me plot it. So plot and I'll pass in this object, which is my tree. Now let me zoom this. So this is our root node and the root node split criteria is on the basis of the petal length column. So we see that if the petal length is less than or greater. So see that if the petal length is less than or equal to 1.9, then we come over here and this tells us that the species of the flower is setosa. On the other hand, if that is not the case, that is if petal length is greater than 1.9, then we have another test condition over here. So here we check if petal width is less than or equal to 1.7. And if it is true, again, we have two scenarios. So here we are checking if petal length is equal to or less than 4.7. So if petal length is equal to or less than 4.7, then there is a 100% probability that the species of the flower is versicolor. Similarly, if the petal length is greater than 4.7, then there is around a 60% probability that the species is versicolor and there is around a 40% probability that the species is virginica. On the other hand, from over here, if we directly come over here and if we check that petal width is greater than 1.7, then in that case, there is almost a 100% probability that the species of the flower is virginica, right? So these are the test conditions on the basis of which we are trying to determine to which class does the species belong to. So now that we've built the model, let's go ahead and predict the values. So I'll use the predict function again. This takes in these parameters. First is the model which we built. So the name of the model is MyTree. And then this is the data set on top of which you want to predict the values. So we want to predict the values on top of the test set. And then finally, we want the response. And that response I'm storing in my pred object. Now after this, let me go ahead and build the confusion matrix. And to build the confusion matrix in R, we'll be using the table function. And the first parameter includes all of the actual values. And the second parameter includes all of the predicted values. And this is what we have over here. So this denotes all of those records where the actual value is setosa. And all of those actual values have been correctly predicted as setosa. So there are 17 such instances. So this denotes all of those records where the actual value is versicolor And all of them have been predicted as Voici color. So there are 16 such instances. And this one denotes those records where the actual was Voici color, but it has been incorrectly classified as Virginica. Similarly, this one over here, this states that there is one record where the actual value is Virginica, but it has been incorrectly classified as Voici color. Similarly, this 16 which we see. So out of the 16 records which were actually Virginica, all of those 16 records have been correctly classified as Virginica. Now again, to find out the accuracy, we are supposed to divide this left diagonal with all of the values. So that'll be 17 plus 16 plus 16 divided by 17 plus 16 plus 16 plus 1 and 1. So we see that we get an accuracy of 96% for the model which we've built. Now let's head on to the next question. So what do you understand by random forest model, and also explain the working mechanism of random forest? So random forest is an ensemble model. That is, it combines multiple models together to get the final output. And to be precise, it combines multiple decision trees together. Now let's understand the working mechanism of random forest model. So let's say we have this data set A and we have n records in it. Now what I'm going to do is draw samples from this dataset. So this actually will be sampling with replacement. That is, I'll take one record from dataset A, take note of it, and enter the same sample in dataset A1, and then put the record back to where it came from. And I'll repeat this process n times so that there are n records in dataset A1 as well. So what you need to keep in mind is, out of these n records in A1, some of them might have come twice, thrice, or even several times over, while some records from A might not have made it at all to A1. So I've created A1 like this. Now I'll go ahead and create multiple datasets the same way. And each of these have the same number of records as A. And the X over here, it could be anything. Let's say 100, 500, or 1000. So from just one dataset A, we were able to create multiple datasets for our advantage. So just for our sake, let's say the dataset A has 1000 rows and the value of X is also 1000. So it would be 1000 cross 1000, which would give us 1 million rows. That is, from just 1000 rows of data, we were able to create 1 million rows. Now for each of these X datasets, we'll fit X decision trees. Now let's say this A1 dataset over here has 10 independent variables. So what happens in a random forest is, each time a node is being split in a decision tree, not all 10 columns will be provided to the algorithm. This is important, so I am retreading it, guys. So each time a node is being split in a decision tree, not all 10 columns will be provided to the random forest algorithm. So now the question arises, what would be made available to the algorithm? So only a random subset of these 10 columns will be available to the algorithm. So let's say I want to split this root node now. So instead of providing it all the 10 columns, only a subset of the columns will be provided. So let's say 3 columns, and it could be any 3 out of the 10. And with those 3, the algorithm goes on to split the node. And similarly, from the left node over here, it is again going to be provided with a random set of 3 variables. And it is not necessary that the left node should get the same 3 variables. It can be a different set of 3 columns altogether. So whenever we are splitting a node, it is given a random set of m predictors from the entire predictor space. And the reason this is done is to make each of these X trees very, very different from each other. Now let's say a new record RI comes our way. Then we are going to pass this record to each of these X trees, and we are going to get each tree's prediction on what class this new record is going to represent. And since we have X trees, we'll get X predictions in total. And to get the final prediction, all we have to do is select that class which would have the majority of the votes across all the predictions of the individual trees. So guys, this is the working mechanism of random forest. So now we'd have to go and build a random forest model on top of the CTG dataset, where NSP is the dependent variable and all other columns are independent variables. So let's head on to RStudio and implement the random forest model. Right, so let me start off by loading the CTG dataset. So I'll use the read.csv function and load this file. Now let me have a glance at this data. So view of data. So this is our dataset, which has all of these rows and columns. And this is our dependent variable where we have these three values, 1, 2, and 3. So this 1 basically means that the person does not have cancer. 2 means that the person is suspected to have cancer. And 3 means that the person has cancer, right? So these are the three different levels associated with this NSP column. Now, let me have a glance at the structure of this dataset. So structure of data. So you see that this NSP column is actually an integer. So we'd have to go ahead and convert this integer type into a factor. So I'll use the as.factor function and convert that NSP column from an integer to a factor. And I'll store that back to same column, data.NSP. Now, let me have a glance at the structure of it again. So structure of data. So see that initially this column was an integer. So using the as.factor function, we have converted this into a factor with 3 levels. Now, let me have a glance at the frequency of the values of this NSP column. So see that there are 1655 patients who don't have cancer, 295 patients who are suspected to have cancer, and 176 patients who do have cancer. So now, before we go ahead and build the model, we are supposed to divide the data set into train and test sets. So first we'll set a seed value. So that seed value would be 1, 2, and 3. Now, I'll go ahead and create the data partition. And the split column is basically this NSP column. And the split ratio which I'm giving over here is 0.65. That is 35% of the records would be in the test set. And the rest 65% of the records would be in the training set. And I'll store this in split tag again. Now from this entire data object, wherever the value of split tag is equal to true, I'll store all of those records in the train set. Similarly, from the entire data object, wherever the value of split tag is equal to false, I'll take them and I'll store them in the test set. So we have our training and testing sets ready. Now again, let me have a glance at the training and testing sets. So n row of train, there are 1383 records in the training set. Similarly, n row of test, there are 743 records in the test set. So now that we've divided the data into training and testing sets, I can go ahead and build the random forest model. So for that purpose, I'd have to load the random forest package. So I'll use library of random forest and I'll load up the random forest function. Now again, I'll set a seed value and the seed value would be 222 and I'll build the model. And I am building the model on top of the train set. So I'm using the random forest function. And this random forest function again takes in 2 parameters. First parameter is the formula. Second parameter is the object or the data set on which we are supposed to build the model. So the formula is NSP tilde dot. That is, this NSP column is our dependent variable and all other columns would be our independent variables. And we're trying to determine whether the person does not have cancer, is suspected to have cancer, or has cancer with respect to all of the other columns. And we are building this model on top of the train set. And I am storing this result in the RF object. Now that we've built the model, let me go ahead and predict the values on top of the test set. So again, I'll be using the predict function. This again takes in 2 parameters. First is the model which we've just built. So the model which we've built, the name of that model was RF. And we are supposed to predict the values for the test set. So I'll give in test over here and I will store the result in the P1 object. Now, let me build a confusion matrix for this. So table and this table function will take in the actual values and the predicted values. So the actual values are stored in the NSP column of the test set and the predicted values are stored in the P1 object. So this is what we have. So this left diagonal represents all of those values which have been correctly classified. So this 567 which you see, so this represents all of those records where the patient actually did not have cancer and it was correctly classified by the model that those patients did not have cancer. So this 8 which you see, This tells you that there were 8 patients or 8 records where the patient did not have cancer, but then again, it has been predicted that the patient is suspected to have cancer. Similarly, this 4 over here, it represents those records where in actuality, the person did not have cancer, but it has been predicted that the person has cancer. Similarly, if we take this row over here, this 20 represents all of those records where that person in actuality is suspected to have cancer, but it has been incorrectly classified that the person does not have cancer. And this 81 represents all of those records where the person is in actuality suspected to have cancer and it has been correctly classified. And that is how it goes for the rest of the records. So if you have to calculate the accuracy, we are supposed to divide this left diagonal with all of the values. So that'll be 567 plus 81 plus 51 divided by all of the values. So 567 plus 81 plus 51 plus we have 2 plus 3 plus 8 plus 4 plus again 2 plus 5 plus 5. And this gives us an accuracy of 96%. So what I've done is I have divided this left diagonal with all of the values. And for the model built, I got an accuracy of 96%. So guys, these are some of the questions which you frequently come across when you appear for data science interviews.
So guys, this brings us to the end of the session. And do stay tuned to Intellipaat's YouTube channel for more such informative videos.